him just cause he asked to put his hands on a massive Gluteus Maximus again. Squeeze it in, switch it in, pass it to a friend. Can he come back as nasty as he can? Yes he can, don't ask me this again. He does not mean to lay me in a fin, but Lindsay, please come back to seeing men. Samantha's a two-year practical.
After a gruesome battle with the elves, the army of Normandun is forced to turn back, half as strong. They didn't see the betrayal of Gabriel coming. It distracted them, causing the elves to gain the upper hand. Along with half the army that came, all three witches and one wizard returned to deliver the news to the king. Upon returning, everyone that survived is either injured or completely spent. The sole remaining wizard, Yazcon, goes forth to the king's chambers to deliver the news of their defeat. All the tired soldiers go home to their wives and children with such tales to tell. They tell not of bloody battle, but of Gabriel the great and brave soldier, defying Normandun in search of his own destiny. The witches say nothing to nobody. They go directly to the cave. They speak amongst themselves. These witches are not the typical witches of fairy tales. They are not old and ugly, and they do not have big moles on their chins, and they do not fly on brooms. Much to the contrary, in fact, you see, these three witches are sisters. They come from a bloodline going back before man even existed. It has been said that the first creature on Earth was a witch. Her name was Lilith, and she lay with the first human, hundreds of years later, and they created a race of witches. It is said that the first witch is the purest, because her blood is not tainted with that of a human. However, the witches we know of in the time of Gabriel the Great are the so-called half-bloods. There are a few witches left on the face of the Earth. The three sisters have wanted to search the globe for their kind for centuries, but the royalty to the kingdom has not permitted it. The eldest of the sisters, a witch named Charlene, has all the years of wisdom, none of which show upon her face. Her face is of flawless beauty. She looks exactly like a human woman of 20. Charlene's younger sisters are identical twins, both coming from the same mother as Charlene, but a different father. The three have been inseparable since birth. The twins have names, but they insist on being called by one and two. And so they are. Charlene, one and two, enter the dark, wet cave, the cave in which they have spent their entire lives, and serve the kingdom for millennia. The witches sit and rest in there while chatting. You know, I had a premonition about Gabriel's betrayal, says two. Others look shocked. Why on earth did she not speak of such a dream to the king, asks Charlene. But she knows why, so they all drop the subject. They all know that King Richard has been the greediest and most selfish king they have ever served. They would all like to see a new king. Two stands up and excuses herself. She takes a little walk around the outside of her cave. See, unlike the others, Two has wanted out for years now. Ever since King Richard became King of Normandun, things have not been the same. She feels as though she is not serving a worthy purpose. Deep down, she feels like the bad guy, the villain. At heart, she's always been a good witch, unlike her creator Lilith, who is pure evil. But Two believes in the Lord Jesus and that he died for everyone. She believes that God gave everyone free will, not just humans. She can remember when she was a young witch, she heard such stories of wonder and mystery from travelers. Some traveled all the way from Israel, preached the word of God. Some came with news of the crucifixion of Jesus of Nazareth. Her sisters laughed at such things, so she did. She didn't want to let down her sisters, and so here she is, many years later, fighting for an evil king of a corrupt empire, and there is no way out. Why could she not be brave like Gabriel the Great? That's what everyone's been calling me since his suicide mission, for she knew the elves would destroy him. Two sits upon a boulder, alone with her thoughts. They race freely, for she is out of range of her sister's psychic links. She thinks of the meaning of her existence, and what she fights for, and how it is long since lost. She thinks of how easy it would have been to stop Gabriel's sword with her magic, and how she did not, causing the kingdom a great loss. And when her mind comes to Gabriel in the flying unicorn. She is for once in her life stumped. What is he? He cannot be human. Humans cannot perform magic spells. She sees it clear as day. Everything she's been through in her extraordinary long life will be worth their trials. She knew to get to the climax of her own life story, to the part of her life that history would write of, she had to go to this Gabriel. She had to help him on whatever it is that is his quest. And so did the witch with no name, other than the number two, take to the air and flight to join the journey of Gabriel the Great.
He walks through the door.